Good afternoon and welcome everybody. I'm Stefan Winterwood and you are watching Safari Live.
Ready?
Standing by.
You are live. Yes, and isn't it a fantastic time to be live out here in the African bush here at Djuma Private Game Reserve in the Sabi Sand Vultane in the Greater Kruger National Park. And there is the star of the moment, young Sindile lying in the shade. For those of you just joining the show, this is a young male leopard with quite a deep history here at Djuma and for Safari Live. He is a cat that we followed with intense interest for the last 23 months of his life. And we are lucky enough to be able to share this afternoon, or some of this afternoon at least anyway, with him. All right, it is a blisteringly hot day today, I must be honest with you. Some of you might notice the massive sheen that's coming off my forehead. That is from the liberal application of SPF 50 million sun cream. And I'm told that it would make a lot of you happy to see some of that on my head and about my face. Right, it's about 88 degrees Fahrenheit, about 30 degrees centigrade, and it's been a pretty busy day out here. We're all gearing up for big changes to come here in the FC. The ladies are going to be moving offices soon, and so these days between drives are absolutely filled to bursting, at least anyway, with a lot of planning. But we don't have to go into that now. We're on game drive now. We got a leopard to share some time with. Obviously covered in fur, the way that these animals are, makes it incredibly difficult for them to regulate effectively their body temperature or their core body temperature. And that means that most of the predators, large anyway, like leopard and lion, find themselves resting up during the day. Now, it's not uncommon to find leopard walking about in the middle of the day. In actual fact, Karula, another one of the famous leopard that we have right here, walks around lots during the day. And it doesn't seem to have infected her grandson. That is exactly who we're looking at the moment. But while he catches his breath and gives us a moment to go across to Brent so that he can say hello to you before he embarks on another one of his epic off-roading adventures. Good afternoon and welcome to a sunny Djuma Private Game Reserve. It is a scorching 31 degrees Celsius, about 88 Fahrenheit, and this is still winter. Well, welcome on our live safari this afternoon. Now, I went to look for the Nkuhuma pride, where we left them snoozing on the sunrise safari. Unfortunately, alas, it looks like they've moved towards a Galago camp where there's some water. Now, unfortunately, the guests are still snoozing, so we'll go back and look for those lions once the guests are out on game drive, so we don't catch anyone in a compromising position. So I think I'm going to go head down into the Mawati River and hope for a bit of Karula magic. And also I heard some elephants moving through this area during the day. So very, very exciting, and I'm sure there's going to be lots and lots to see. Even if they aren't the big hairies and scaries, there are always birds, bugs and reptiles to look for. And if you want to know anything about all these wonderful things out here, pop me an email to questions@wildearth.tv, or you can use the hashtag Safari Live on Twitter. Now, of course, this morning was most enjoyable. We barely had to move and everything popped out in front of us. Oh, there we go. Here are the Ellies I heard. Wonderful. So even the Ellies have a time of the day where they're not too active. It is normally sometimes during the heat, but in this drought, they're having to constantly feed to keep that massive body well fed. But I do see a cute little baby doing something interesting in the drainage line, so I'm going to sneak forward a bit.
And what are you up to? Is that who I think it is? Can't be. Can't be that big already. Let's just wait till he shows us his forehead, but it did look like it could be Benjamin Button. But I don't think so. I think it's a bit too big. Well, maybe. Look at the wrinkles on his head. Is that Benji? Benji, you've grown since I last saw you. So, of course, that little one's not too concerned with feeding. It's getting most of its sustenance from mom. Now, one of the reasons you find dead baby Ellies in droughts like this is due to the mothers not being able to get enough nutrients and not being able to produce enough milk. Now, if we're really lucky, they might head towards the Djuma pan. Well, a very exciting to have Sheila in Norway on the drive with us today. Sheila says she's just found the channel, so a big welcome to you, Sheila. Now, Sheila says she was on safari a few years ago and got charged by an elephant, and her guide laughed it off and said it wasn't serious. She says, how can you know? And why do these animals not attack with the smell of human beings and gasoline so close to them? Well, Sheila, it sounds like you had a naughty safari guide who didn't explain things properly to you. But when you're watching elephants, body language is a very important thing to let them know. They'll let you know whether it's serious or not. So sometimes it's a tiny little stiffness in the legs or the way it raises its head. But for me, one of the best telltale signs if an elephant's angry is its tail. If there's a bit of stiffness in the tail. And you can see these elephants are completely relaxed. And her tail is swaying happily. And I'm going to show you how relaxed they are, Sheila. I'm just going to move my vehicle back a little bit. Now, she's taking absolutely no notice of me. Now, elephants in this area are quite used to the safari vehicles. Hello, big girl. And now, one must remember that human beings don't really smell like what an elephant would instinctively think a human being to smell like. We smell of deodorant and shampoo and clothes wash, and a car and it smells of gasoline and oil have only been around for just over 100 years. So there's no instinctive response to those smells. Now, with elephants as well, they're not as scared of human beings generally as quite a lot of the other animals. And very few people would have hunted elephants in a prehistoric time. It's only in the modern era. So in certain areas where elephants are persecuted, they have developed a fear, a natural fear of man that can make them very, very aggressive. But in areas like this where they're completely protected, you can see they take no notice of us whatsoever. However, if we do see an elephant that is showing some of those signs that it might be aggressive, we don't hang around. We don't want to irritate the animal. We don't want to be charged by animals. Quite often, we might get an elephant bull shake his head at us, or we'll get charged by a little one who's just playing. But generally, we're here to observe, not to interfere. And as you can see, isn't this wonderful? Observing very carefully. Now, if you look closely in her left tusk, you can see there's a little notch. And it's called a grass notch. So this elephant is left-handed, and that's from wringing grass and branches constantly over that spot, using that tusk to be able to rip or break things. And like human beings, they have a preference of side, and she's a left-tusked elephant. And here comes the little one. Hasn't quite mastered the art of the trunk yet. So often they're just sort of feeling around, trying to get to grips with having this long appendage on the front of their face. And lucky for him, he doesn't need it to feed himself just yet. He's got mum. Now, eating a little raisin bush at the moment. And the elephants, over the last while, I've been counting the number of different species that they're feeding on. And my record in a herd in about 10 minutes is 14 different species. And a lot of those species are species the elephants wouldn't traditionally feed on. But because we're experiencing the worst drought since the early 90s, they are feeding on lots of different species that are not their favorites, but at the moment all nutrients counts. Oh, but a little one. Little one's having a scratch against the bush willow there. Got an itchy side. Off to go cause mischief. Now I think we're going to spend some time with these great grey pachyderms. While we do that, let's go across to Steph and the incredible Sindile.
Yes, this is pretty special, spending some time with a male leopard like this, nice and relaxed, not more than 30 or 40 yards from the vehicle that we're sitting in at the moment. And he's just panting away, deliberately panting like that. Not only does he have a belly that's just full of Impala at the moment, that Impala is busy digesting, and he is an uncomfortable kitty cat, I think. That panting is a sign that he's got a full belly, one, but it's also a sign that it's pretty hot today. They can evaporate moisture off of their throat and their tongue, which cools them down a lot. There's a lot of blood vessels inside the tongue and the throat. And so that panting that they're doing over there creates that transfer of heat, and is something that even your domestic dogs and cats will do at home. You can actually see the pink inside the tongue. They've got a very red tongue. And that is because it's so jam-packed with blood vessels. Ah, there we go. He knew we were talking about his tongue. Have a look at those canines. Leopard, with the exception of caracal, have some of the longest canines in relation to their skull's diameters. And they make for incredibly good grasping handles or anchors. And what you're seeing there are the bottom canines. You can just see the canine sticking out there with the one incisor that we can see not covered by his tongue. And you can just imagine how thick those top canines are. Probably about as big as your baby finger. So if you hold up your baby finger, that's about as long as what they are, those bottom ones. But the same diameter as well. And they then go backwards from there to a set of premolars that are designed to shear and cut. And that is how he would have cut off chunks of that Impala. He would have bitten into it, creating a slight hole or a depression, and then moved from his canine through to his incisor, biting off a chunk of meat and then wolfing it down. And quite capable of swallowing about a quarter of his body weight in a sitting. Predators have developed this bolting mechanism just so that they can keep as much of the meat they catch as possible. Don't forget, out here it's all a race for the easiest way to get food. And hyena and lion will absolutely steal kills from leopard, and do steal a lot of kills from leopard. So the more meat he can get in his belly, the quicker, the better for him, even if he has to relinquish his kill. Now, leopard, being the adaptable cats that they are, long ago realized that it was easier to hoist kills into trees. And as those of you who have watched for this morning and potentially yesterday would have seen, he had a kill hoisted in the tree, or in a tree, just out of hyena reach. And so the only other thing that could have stolen that kill from him would have been a lion or another leopard. Just see where he's lying up in the shade there now, panting. Almost invisible in that shade, in actual fact. Aaron, all the way from New Zealand. Good evening, Aaron. Yes, sleeping is incredibly hot work, or must be at least anyway. I don't know, where we're sitting at the moment, we are baking in the sun. I can only imagine if my belly was full of Impala, I would also be panting away there. But really, that's just to cool him down. They can't tolerate heat. I mean, leopard are found into deserts, not true deserts, not onto sand dunes, but right onto the very edge of true deserts. And so they are fairly resistant to temperature increases and decreases. I think the highest that a leopard was ever found, there was a leopard found on the slopes of Kilimanjaro frozen, or in the Himalayas somewhere frozen at a couple of thousand feet above sea level. What that exactly is, I'm not too sure. But for those of you who are interested in those types of facts and figures, see if you can find the highest altitude leopard have ever been found at, or at least their presence has ever been found at. You're welcome to share that answer with me via email on questions@wildearth.tv or using the hashtag Safari Live, and I'll share it with everybody else here as well this afternoon. Remembering, of course, that is how you can speak to me and how we can keep in touch throughout the afternoon. Now, leopard are perfect ambush specialists, and that you're seeing there now, although not with his eyes closed at this particular moment, would be the last thing that most Impala and Steenbuck and Nyala and Dacre and Warthog will see, is just this spotty face surrounded by a ruff of fur, pink tongue, white teeth, and those very, very strong forearms. Have a look at how well developed and muscular those forearms are. And inside those forearms are housed the muscles that hold on to the tendons that erect the claws that come out of his paws. They have sheathed claws, similar to your house cat. In other words, they are housed inside a sheath that you see there in his toe. He can then erect those claws, and they are wickedly sharp, curved claws. Five on his front foot, four on his back foot. They are used to then grab the prey and turn it, using his back legs as well, turn the prey into a position where he can bite, usually either to the back of the neck, the skull, or underneath the jawbone. Now, it was always thought that leopard primarily strangle their prey, but I personally think that so, Shamel, I'll answer your question in a second. For a long time, I actually thought that leopard, well, it's commonly known that that leopard will strangle their prey and do so. But I think that leopard will employ a different way of killing different things and can learn them at an individual individual level. And recent developments have led people to believe that those long canines are actually and can actually be used to cut off blood flow in the carotid artery, which brings on a type of unconsciousness in their prey very, very quickly in actual fact. And that's just another one of those adaptations to limit noise and distress and disturbance, which will call in other predators very, very quickly. Shamel, you've asked about leopard or about Sindile losing his prey. I don't actually know, Shamel, to be quite honest. The tree that he had his prey in is just behind us, but has nothing in at the moment. He seems to have come into the shade. I don't know if he's lost the kill to an impala. Oh, lost his kill to a hyena at least anyway. But let's see if he's maybe stashed it somewhere else. There's a good chance that he stashed it on this termite mound somewhere. Let's have a careful look around the termite mound. Starting at the base of the tree. It's not in the tree. I think even he would find it difficult to put his kill inside there. No, I can't see anything more. He may have actually finished it. I mean, there wasn't too much left. I doubt that he finished all of that. I'm actually convinced that it's lying here somewhere. We just can't see it. What we're going to do is wait for him just to get hungry in a bit and stand up and go find it. Or stand up and move to it. But it may have fallen out of the tree and he's just been too hot or too lazy or couldn't have been bothered to put it back in again. And now just relaxing in the sun, or in the shade, out of the sun. Ch- Chi-Town Connie. Wow, what a name. You've just asked me how many kilos of meat can a leopard consume in a sitting. They can do about 25% of their body weight. And I estimate this young Sindile to weigh about 50 kilograms, 40 to 50 kilograms, maybe a little bit more than that. So a quarter of that would be, what is a quarter of that? Would be probably 17 kilograms, 15 to 17 kilograms of meat. Now, do yourself a favor and go and spoon out 17 kilograms of dog food into a bowl and see if you can swallow all of that. That's a lot. They can basically swell up so much that their bellies almost come past their back legs like a balloon. Ah, SF, who's a new viewer, and firstly, I'd like to say welcome to the Wild Earth family, and I'm sure that you're going to have lots and lots of fun with us. But excuse me, I haven't talked about the collar that you've been looking at for the last few minutes. That particular collar that that leopard has on is a scientific instrument which pegs his GPS coordinate from time to time, and it was put there because he's under scientific investigation after having been quarantined as suspected for having contracted a rabies virus from him killing a domestic dog that had wandered into this reserve, a rabid dog that had wandered into this reserve. He killed it, and we all decided that it would be a good thing to request help from the local veterinary services, who then caught the animal, quarantined him, and then released him here a couple of months ago. And we use those collars to gather as much information as we can about this particular, or these cats, and in particular this particular cat, has added a level of confusion to the scientific world. And the reason for that is that males usually disperse from their natal range. They're supposed to, by nature, move away from where their mothers and their sisters live for obvious reasons of inbreeding. This particular male walked away as expected, and then from as far as 50 or 60 miles away, he walked all the way back again. And for no reason that the scientific community can understand. There's some speculation that because the Kruger National Park closed off a lot of watering holes, that food was just very hard to come by on the periphery of the Sabi Sands where we are now. And just by chance, he happened to come back and then stumble across his natal range. And only being 23 months old, he's still not really old enough to have left his natal range just yet. A leopard that wasn't taken away and quarantined will only be thinking about moving away from 2 years or so. And so the thought is that he's just hanging around close to mom. He's not a dominant male just yet, so he's not a threat to mating rights with other dominant male leopards in the area. So as long as he stays submissive and knows his manners, he will be tolerated. And isn't it just an amazing story that he managed to find his way back? And he's once again, he's not reunited with his mother. His mother has got a new cub, and so she won't tolerate him around. But it's not uncommon for mother leopard to make kills, go and fetch older cubs, bring them to kills, and then leave again. They help their babies out, in other words. So it would be interesting, actually, to find out whether or not he actually killed this impala, or whether his mother, a leopard we call Shadow, killed it and left it for him. Gee whiz, James Richard, you just helped us out with that, the highest a leopard has ever been found. And it was on the slopes of Kilimanjaro in 1919, ages ago, on the banks of some crater there that was at a height of 18,500 feet. That is an unbelievably high altitude for leopard to occur at. It was actually found frozen, the carcass was found frozen, but just goes to show that leopard are some of the most adaptable cats. They're found from the edges of our cities in South Africa, And in fact, all the way across their range, you get different subspecies of leopard, but pretty much from Cape Town up through Africa, across onto Asia, and all the way through to the eastern side of China, you get some form of Panthera pardus, or the leopard. Very adaptable. So from 18,500 feet right onto the beach at sea level, from basically full jungle all the way through to just at the edge of dune sand deserts. Now, some would attribute that to just how hardy these cats are. I attribute it to a big intelligence. So Mark, you've asked what tools we use to identify different leopard. Now Mark, it's a combination of what their general, it's a combination of the general impression of this leopard's size and his shape, any distinguishing marks like scars or whatever, you know, it could be an anomaly on the coat or on his tail. But the actual one is using that spot on the face, and there just above the whisker to the right hand side of his nose, there's three lines or four lines of whisker spots, those they'll use. And then you can see this particular leopard has what looks like one spot and then two spots right next to one another. That'll be unique to every leopard. That is like, and that and other small little telltale marks are what we use to distinguish which leopard is which. Now, as this leopard will get bigger, he will move off probably. The dominant males in this particular area, or males that are larger than him, will not tolerate him around when he starts to compete with them for mating rights with females, and they'll chase him from one area to another until he's big enough and strong enough to say, or push open a territory of his own, or oust another male, an elder male, or a male that's past his prime in another area. And he will have roughly an area of, I don't know, it varies depending on how close or far you are from river systems and from natural water, but around about 5,000 hectares here in the Sabi Sands is large, just on the large side for male leopard territories. And he'll have a number of female territories in that. They will know of one another, obviously. They roar and they scent mark, and although they don't hunt together, they are very aware of what females are where in their territories. And when a female is exhibiting signs of coming into estrus, generally speaking, they will find the male, the most dominant male in their area, and through a lot of teasing, something caught his attention, could have just been a fly or a grasshopper. The females will elicit mating. They mate for about 5 days or so, up to a week, and then they go on their separate ways again. Females are solitary mothers, with the male leopard not taking any role in the upbringing of kids whatsoever. You can see that full belly that he's got there now, just sticking out of the top. Usually if he was not full of impala, that would be a sleek, continuous line. And you can see that breathing, that meat pushing against his diaphragm, and then also that panting to try and keep his core body temperature down. Very good condition, this male leopard, to be honest. I mean, for a youngster that's not really tied to his mother, having had the history that he's had, I mean, 9 months living in a quarantine facility, many, many, many people thought that he'd come out not fit enough to actually look after himself or to defend himself against anything. But, you know, contrary to popular belief, he's managed to do all of that on his own. All right. So on that note, we are going to send you back to Brent, who has got an update, whatever he's been doing for the last couple of minutes for you.
So those Ellies have moved off into the thicket, and we're still waiting patiently for the Gallagher Death to get out on drive so we can go scrounge around for the Nkuhumas. I decided to take a little drive up one of my favourite roads, Nyala Road North, and see how the dry of Buffalo's Hook is going. You never know what you're going to find. That's the joy of being on a life safari. Yesterday I was looking at an elephant and I found a bagworm land on my head. Now there's a jackalberry here. I'm waiting to find a leopard in. One day we're going to see a leopard in this tree. Every time I drive past it, I keep looking for tree climbing bushbuck. Unfortunately, no luck. But can we try and have a look at this one fruiting? It might be worth our while to go past the big fruiting one down at Twin Dams. Always lots of action around there.
Welcome back. You know, Brent is having a little bit of signal issues there on Nyala Road South, the black hole for our signals out here. Sindile has just looked up and seems to be just be relaxing. I think he had a fly buzzing around his ear a little earlier. That was giving him that jerkiness that you had there. Let's have a look. While we are close like we are now, have a look at that black and white stripe on his ear. Now that is a following mechanism. That's how leopards talk to one another. So they use their ears and, well, a variety of things. One, ears is one of the tools they use. And that black and white stripe will be used to signal cubs that are walking behind them. And that, in combination with their tail, which for him we can't really see, but at the bottom of their tail is a pure white, about finger length piece of hair. It's very expressive. We can't see it now. I'm just trying to see if we can actually. No, maybe in a bit we'll be able to see it. But that black and white stripe on his ears plus the white tip underneath his tail, following mechanism, that's how they will speak to their cubs when their cubs are following them and tell them a variety of things. Get out of danger, stay behind, stay hidden. Who knows what they can communicate to those ears. And then if you look at his bottom eyelid, you'll see an almost white stripe. Now when he opens up his eye, of course not now. Alright, and now just because I want to speak about it, he's keeping his eyes tight shut. You almost think I can hear you. But it will allow me to talk about leopard intelligence. Their adaptability, for me at least, oh look at that, there we go. Oh, amazing. I hope some of you got some screen grabs. There, he's just resetting there, got a bit of hair. Oh, look at that. Look at those massive canines. Wow. That is impressive. Thank you. Look at the sharpness of those teeth. Very, very good condition. Quite often, older leopard have broken off canines. It's just the habits that they live. Tooth and claw. They get knocked out by being kicked and bitten through and bones, really tough bones, might shatter a canine. Being kicked by something might shatter a canine. He's still got his. And just look at the condition of those teeth. Wow. And for those of you who are fussed enough on your keyboards and got that quick snap of the inside of his mouth, you'll be privy to those carnassial shears, those teeth that act like scissors that you'll be able to see in the roof of his mouth and on his bottom jaw. They fit into each other like a zigzag pattern. And will be used to cut out chunks of meat. So for those of you who are lucky enough to get shots of that, please share them around the community. Once again, you can send them to the hashtag Safari Live, pitch them up at emails, attach them to the emails, you know, questions@wildearth.tv. All right. So Stuart, you've just asked me, are leopards vulnerable after they've eaten? This leopard looks like he's lying down, having difficulty just breathing, let alone looking after himself. Good point there, Stuart. They are actually, to be quite honest with you. They are wary. Leopards who are not wary don't survive being cubs for very long. And so unwary leopards very rarely have the chance to mate and give birth to unwary cubs. And so wariness is just one of those things that leopards are sort of born with. Just wary cubs grow up and make wary babies, and you can see him very alert. But yes, essentially, being full, lying on the side of a termite mound, leaves him open to attack from lion and from hyena. And a lot of leopard are killed by both of those super predators. Other leopard, not at the size that he is at the moment. He's in that comfortable cusp between being a tiny cub, which dominant male leopards sometimes cannibalize, and being a full-grown adult male that is actually a threat to the dominant male leopard in this area. He's in that comfortable cusp where big males are leaving him alone, and he's not really in the danger of being cannibalized by a male leopard looking to bring his mother back into estrus. Now back onto why I think leopard are so adaptable. They actually have a bigger brain in their heads than what lion do, from what I'm told. I've never poured water into a leopard's brain case to actually figure out how much volume it actually holds. Neither have I lions, although I've looked into both. They seem of a similar size. But I suppose if you factor in that leopard are about 4 times smaller than what lion are, it makes sense that they have a bigger brain per volume, and that is the measure of intelligence. And they are very adaptable. They can learn to hunt different things and to adapt to different environments very, very, very easily, as this young male leopard has obviously shown with his collar on, and from such a young age being so independent. Now, while he stares balefully off into the distance, we're going to send you off to Brent, who's got an update for you.
So I have mentioned we're in the worst drought since the early 90s, and you can see the Buffalo's Hook waterhole is barely even a mud wallow, and there's one poor young hippo bull, by the looks of things, who's trying to get some protection from the sun out of the last little bits of remnant mud. Now, he might look dead, but he's not. Every now and then his ear flicks. It's really, really tough on the hippos during the drought. As you can see, he's just managed to cover himself in mud. He might try and roll once the top gets a bit hot, but I don't think he's going to be able to last the afternoon here. He'll probably have to get out, and he'll move into one of these dry river systems and try sleep it in the shade. But it is quite a tough thing to see sometimes, and I know a lot of you get quite affected by the drought, and we get a lot of questions. Why don't we feed? Why don't we pump water into the dam for them? Well, it is nature, and drought is as natural as a hippo or as a tree. And drought is nature's great leveler. It helps to control populations that are too big of both trees and animal species. And we must remember, as human beings, we might think we know better, but we don't. We are gardeners in Eden. And we've taken a perfect system, and now we're trying to better it. So my vote is we just let nature take its course. But shame. Let's leave that poor hippo to his slumber in the remnants of the Buffalo's Hook waterhole. Well, hi, raccoon pet. Raccoon pet would like to know, is that hippo stuck? He's not. He's purposely got himself into that mud to try to protect himself from the sun a little bit. Shame. Poor man. Now, I know it's a male, and I can see it's actually a young male there, just judging from the size of his head. It's very unlikely that you're ever going to find a female stuck in a little bit of mud like that. It's not impossible, it's unusual. So what happens where there is water left, and there's some water left to the north of us, all the females and the big dominant males are going to be there. So he's not strong enough to compete for females yet, so he's been forced into what little bit of moisture he can find. And he pops up and around the Djuma dam cam in that water there, but I think the lions all around there forced him to move away. Okay, so We're going to head up to our northern boundary. I'm going to sneak down to the east and start slowly making our way towards the last position of the Nkuhumas. Hi, Joey. Joey would like to know, are crocodiles scared of hippos? Most definitely. Now, Joey's been watching James up in the Masai Mara. And during the crossings, he said he noticed the crocodiles took no notice of the female hippo with her baby. Now, that's a massive risk, even for a monster crocodile, to go after a female hippo, which would probably be too big for her, but even to go after the baby, her reaction is going to be extreme. So, especially in a situation like that, there are certain circumstances where maybe a crocodile would be desperate enough to go for a baby hippo. But you're sitting there in the Masai Mara, you've got 1.5 million wildebeest who are definitely going to jump into that river. So why would you risk going for something like a hippo that has a possible very bad ending for you when you can just grab a wildebeest as it goes past? Oh, giraffe! And strange enough, I just got a call on the radio. Has anyone seen giraffe today? Mike, two in Dulamiti crossing from Buffles Hook into Vuyatela, directly behind Buffles Hook Dam. Now, I hope they're not marching off to Buffles Hook for a drink, because I think they're going to be sorely disappointed. Standing by. Hey, Herbie's on the search for a male lion. He's just asking what roads I've checked. I checked Central to Nyala Road North. So it's two male giraffe, and they are heading back towards Buffles Hook Water. I think it might be worth us staying with them to see if they are going looking for water. Now, it's quite nice at this, in the heat of the day, to find an animal that's on the move like that. So we'll definitely go see them. They're seriously marching. And also have a little confession. There's another reason I'm checking around here. It's because the last place the wild dogs were seen was opposite here. So, of course, I've got my fingers crossed that the wild dogs might make an appearance. Where are you two off to? Now, for a second, I thought they might be chasing each other, but just looking at them, they're both relatively young males, so it's not impossible, but it's unlikely. The bigger one seems to be leading, so let's have a look. And they're disappearing into that little river system now. That leads into the Buffles Hook waterhole. Oh, they're going straight through it. They got a little bit of speed. I had to get up the hill. Yeah, you know. Well, maybe with their tall height, they've already seen that there's no water. Change their direction. Might not have been heading to the waterhole. There they are. Could be a bit of a... No, I don't think they're fighting or chasing each other. looks like that might come down. Let me just reposition it. They're going to be very disappointed as they come down here if they're looking for a drink. Oh, the hippo's out. See, I didn't think he was going to spend his whole afternoon there. I think he got too hot. So he's going to more than likely make his way into that little river system behind the dam wall. And spend some time in the shade. Now the giraffe are not coming down here. They've kept going south, but let's stick with the hippo. Shame, poor boy. Quite a steep back he's got to attempt. There we go, he's got his four-wheel drive on. Now, of course, lack of water is not the only problem for this poor hippo. It's lack of grass. There's very, very little grass around, and hippos can do up to 30 kilometers each way, 60 kilometers in a night in search of grass during the dry season in other parts of Africa. And you can see how dry it is as the dust comes off his feet. Angela, who's in Boston, Massachusetts. You must be a Bruins fan, Angela. Now, Angela says, when are the rains expected? I can't believe how dry it is. Well, there is a lot of debate around when the rains are expected, Angela. There's a lot of bets going on. I say it's going to be very dry. I don't think we're going to get rains early this year. And even once our rainy season does commence, I don't think it's going to be a very good season. So I've said, and I said the 10th of November. And when we say classify as decent rain, has to be over 20 mils. Brian and Dave have said the 18th and 19th of September, which is just around the corner. Vim, where were you?
You can't remember.
Well, you get to choose another one. VM, 1st of October, James was, I think, 10th of October, and Steph also the 10th of October, so I hate to be the pessimist, but it seems like everyone's a lot more optimistic than I am about when the rains are coming, so there's lots of debate whether it's going to be a La Nina or El Nino continued, so, and the research I've done, as much as people think we're going to have floods and La Nina is coming, I can find just as much information to say El Nino is going to continue. So I should probably stick to Hemingway's advice, and that's, there's two things one should never try to predict: the weather and the woman's moods. Oh, hello, buffalo. I wondered where all the buffalo bulls have been hiding since the Nkuhumas have moved in around the camp. Hello, old boys. Now, the largest group of buffalo bulls I've ever seen in my life was at this very waterhole, when of course there was still water, but we counted 58 buffalo bulls in a group together here. Oh, that one on the right's got some serious character. They always do have lots of character. Yeah, look at that guy, broken both tips of his horns. Seems to be the oxpecker's favorite as well. Maybe the most infected with ticks. Infested, not infected. Cumbrant English language. Red-billed oxpeckers. Always have a look when you're with buffalo. See if there's not a yellow-billed. We went through a lucky patch on the buffalo bulls where we had yellow-billed for about 10 days in a row, but I haven't seen a yellow-billed oxpecker in quite some time. So they're just quietly ruminating in the shade. Now you can start seeing the hips show on quite a few of these buffalo. And the Nkuhumas are having great success in hunting them. Tough time to be an old buffalo bull. Not only is there not a lot of water and grass around, the Nkuhuma pride is growing and are very hungry. Well, let's leave the buffaloes to ruminate on their unluck or bad luck this year with the drought. And I think since it's hot and the animals aren't out and about and moving just yet, it's time for a quiz. Now, because it's my birthday tomorrow, I think my quiz is going to be about my favorite animal. Aha. What country and what game reserve holds the largest population of African wild dogs? So the biggest single population in one particular area in Africa. What game reserve and what country is that in? And remember, answers through to questions at WildEarth.tv or use the hashtag SafariLive on Twitter. But now, as Steph has, I'm sure, warned you, we've got Alan, who's going to be trying out on an interview drive this afternoon. And please don't go like that. What's that movie? Alan. So without further ado, over to Alan.
And a very good afternoon to the community who I'm talking to all over the world, and it is my great pleasure to join you from Safari Live here in the beautiful Djuma Game Reserve in the Sabi Sands. I believe I heard Brent's very animated introduction of me, and thank you for that, Brent. I'm Alan, and yeah, it's a pleasure for me to be able to spend the next few minutes and hours of this afternoon's drive and perhaps explore and expose a couple of the subtleties that are around us in this gorgeous, gorgeous game reserve. I know that Brent was talking to you a little bit earlier about the condition of the buffalo and the results and success of lions hunting them during what is an environmentally challenging period that we are going through. If one takes a look at the expanse of the bushveld around us, it's got a very much kind of a slightly drab overview in comparison to what one might experience in a couple of months' time, perhaps. But gorgeous all the same, you know, these skeletal trees, the dramatic starkness of the bushveld at this time of year is just such a hauntingly beautiful time, and one of my favorite times of year, in actual fact, when you get the sunrises that you enjoyed this morning with Sindile, and yeah, the dusty sunsets, all of the great colors that we enjoy. But for the remainder of this afternoon, we're going to be trying to take a look around. We've just left Sindile about 10 minutes ago. He wasn't looking to do very much, in actual fact. He seemed fairly content with that stomach full of impala, and he I think perhaps invited us to go and explore a little bit more of what's out there this afternoon, and so we'll do just that. And if you'll bear with us as we head out and see if there's anything more that we can find for you that you may enjoy alongside with us. Liz, I believe that you wanted to know how I spelled my name. Now, my name, first name, Alan, A-L-A-N, and then I've got quite an interesting surname, which is pronounced Yowart, but it's spelled Y-E-O-W-A-R-T. And as far as I understand, it originates from Cumbria or some parts of northern England, but I'm a third or fourth generation South African, and so that's obviously where my roots are right now. But Alan is Alan Yowart is my name. Carol, pleasure to meet you, and I'm from a small town called White River, which is probably about an hour and a half or 2 hours drive from here, closest major town being Nelspruit, but yeah, very close by and always within launching distance to one or other of these game reserves, which are adjacent to the Kruger National Park, which is a great pleasure to be. Good afternoon, Debbie. You asked a little bit about my background as we sit with a gorgeous little group of zebra. I've been guiding and in the safari guiding industry for about 22 years now, Debbie, and I have grown up with this as part of my upbringing in and around the South Africa's bushveld areas, and so I've began my career in the Sabi Sand Game Reserve just under 23 years ago, and I've worked in and around Kruger and various parts of Africa ever since then, not having done anything else. And so guiding and the training of field guides has been all that I've done, and it's a wonderful, wonderful career, and it's actually where I know Steph from, and Brent. All of us as paths have crossed. Oh, listen to these urgent alarm calls, which have originated as a result of a bird of prey that just took off from a tree in front of us, but unfortunately it's flown well out of our sight. But yeah, it's if you're in the industry for long enough, there's those you sometimes part ways with some of your colleagues, and then eventually those sort of pathways rejoin one another. And it's with great happiness that I get to spend some time with the likes of Steph and Brent, and yeah, let's see where this next leg of our journey takes us. It's a very exciting conjuncture. Just as we're sitting here, somewhat lackadaisically, not really taking note of these beautiful animals to the side of the vehicle, I know that James was viewing this species on the banks of the Mara River in Kenya yesterday afternoon. And yeah, we just so privileged to get to enjoy these beautiful animals in the various reserves and safari destinations throughout Africa, and particularly here in the Sabi Sand, where they just seem so at peace with one another and with our presence in the vehicles. Conditions, as Brent was alluding to earlier, not that easy for these animals that eat or need lots and lots of grass, as these zebra do. Resources are a little bit scant at the moment.
And so it does mean that the animals do need to spend a lot of time feeding, a lot of time trying to find food, and there will be times when their condition does deteriorate as a result of deteriorating resources. But again, as may well have been alluded to, you know, these times of environmental stress do have a purpose, and the purpose of strengthening the genetic resources for breeding populations going forward is critical, you know. And if everything was too easy and too abundant, you would find that individuals who weren't meant to breed got a far more available opportunity to do so, and hence would result in the weakening of the genetic pool or the genetic resources around. So we'll watch these zebra as they move along just past this termite mound that they've spent a little bit of time feeding against. The termite mounds themselves, if you can have a look on the one side, I'm just going to move forward a fraction. Now, with the bush in general being incredibly heavily grazed, it's not as obvious, but there is still a semblance of what we would call a halo grazing effect, which results from the incredibly high palatability of the grass and general foliage available on and adjacent to termite mounds. So hence they are the first selected areas which are grazed by these animals. And these zebras were no exception, you know. They would have spent some time standing on the termite mound, working around the base of it, and then moving off once the resources had dwindled. And for these guys, it's a lot of this day is going to be spent seeking out some palatable grasses that can take them into the night and hopefully on to the next morning. So as we continue, we're going to carry on looking for whatever else is in store for us, and I'd like to hand you back to Brent, and let's see what he's got in store for you in the next couple of minutes or so.
So, Queen Karula has been absent, and sometimes when she is absent, it's always a good idea to check Ledwood Road. She tends to just sneak across here. Now, the southern boundary is not too far away, but of course it's a main access road, so there are lots of vehicles up and down. So it does make tracks sometimes hard to see. But I am quite happy because there are civet tracks on top, which means no one has driven Ledwood, at least since yesterday. This is not the most relaxed little group of dwarf mongoose. Not hanging around to say hello. Oh, no, there's one. It looks like a young one as well. Hello, little guy. Now, the smallest member of the carnivore family in Africa. Aren't they just too delightful? Now, I know a lot of our regular viewers would have heard the story a few times, but I'm going to tell you again, but I just need to chat to Tax quickly. Tax, just Sindile and then Nkuhuma's have moved towards Galago. I'm waiting for Aubrey to get out so I can go check. There we go. Negative, still same position. Look at that. So it's always wonderful if you sit quietly, they do become quiet. quite relaxed. Now, the reason I like them so much is because their social structure is very similar to that of my favorite animal, the African wild dog. They live in businesses, is the collective noun for a group of mongoose, a business of mongoose. And they have alpha pairs, and who do the breeding, and the rest of the mongoose help rear the babies. Now, one of the more fascinating things that sets them apart from most animals in the African bush, and particularly most other members of the order Carnivora, is that when an alpha dies, and there happen to be two beta individuals who are very similarly socially ranked and of course of the same sex, in most circumstances a battle to the death or a battle to expulsion would take place. But mongoose, dwarf mongoose, have a love-off. So they're basically the most affectionate can... Sorry guys, just one second. So they have basically a love-off. So the most affectionate of the mongooses wins. And they can actually keep grooming each other for up to a day. And literally they look like they've been dropped in a bucket of water. They're so covered in saliva. Bye, little guys. So, a big welcome to Salem Middle School in Virginia Beach. Great to have you on a live African safari, and I look forward to having lots of questions from you. I think this is your first time on a safari, so great to have Salem with us. Now, to let you know what I'm up to, I'm in search for a leopard, and then I'm going to go in search of a lion. So, I haven't seen our dominant female leopard in this area for a few days. This is one of the areas that she does like to frequent, so I'm just checking for her footprint. So that's how we track a lot of the big cats and animals out here, is that we look for their footprints. But of course, it's not always only about the big cats. We love to look at everything, the trees, even the dirt, insects, flowers, butterflies, and of course, some of the other big animals like elephants and giraffe and zebra. Okay, so I'm heading now down towards a little dry creek system called the Mawati, and because it's quite hot, it's about 88 Fahrenheit here, and can you believe it, we're at the end of winter, so a beautiful late winter's day for us here in the African bush, and there's lots of nice big trees, lots of shade, so we might find some animals snoozing in that shade. So again, a big welcome to Salem. Great to have you on the back of the world's biggest, I was going to say biggest safari vehicle, but I could say today the world's biggest classroom. Okay, so guys, I'm really excited for your questions, so send them in. What are you wondering about Africa? And apologies that there are no animals on screen at the moment, but I'll try find some for you as quick as possible. But that is the thing about being live in the African bush. We can't plan it. The animals are there or they aren't. We can't make them be there. This is not a zoo. There's no fences. And the animals can meander wherever they might please. So far, all I can see are the footprints of antelope. So none of the big cat footprints yet. And you look on the road ahead and see there's been a lot of them. And it's probably an impala herd. So I'm hoping we're going to find one for you now. Now, you guys in the States, you guys get deer. Now, we don't get any deer that occur naturally in southern Africa. And I wonder if anyone knows what the difference between a deer and an antelope is, or one of the main differences. How about I test you? Because yeah, I'm waiting for your question. So while I'm waiting for your questions, I'm going to ask you a question. What is the main difference between a deer and an antelope? So if you're wondering where we are in the middle of the African bush, but we're in the country of South Africa, in the Greater Kruger National Park. So Wim, my cameraman, has spotted a creature. Where's he gone, Wim? Oh, there he is. I was looking in the distance, but there's a big male warthog right next to the car. So this is a wild pig, but we call him a warthog, and I know it's a big male because on the side of his face you can see he's got two sets of warts. Now, hello, Karin. Great to have you with us. Karin would like to know, are the bear trees dead or just barren? So they're deciduous trees, Karin, so they've lost their leaves for our winter months. We are coming towards the end of winter now. And so, well, some of them might be dead if the elephants have got to them, but most of them are indeed alive. So here we go, a nice big warthog boar. And let me just see if we... I hope he's going to move out from behind that bush. But what he's doing is he's using his nose to dig into the soil. So we are experiencing an incredible drought, so food is quite scarce. And he's trying to dig out the roots of those plants. And here he is. You can see he's got big tusks for defending himself. So the big tusks we can see there are very impressive, but not the real main weapons that he uses to defend himself. So I'm hoping he's going to turn his head in a little bit. He's actually moving the little sticks and stuff there to try. There we go. So underneath those big tusks, as you can see as he chomps his mouth there, he's got small tusks that are very, very sharp. And those big top tusks rub against them. And they can be as sharp as a razor blade. And even a leopard would think twice about tangling with a big warthog like this. And those very sharp tusks could do some serious damage. Oh, it's been a long time since I've been in the principal's office. I did spend quite a bit of time there when I was at school, but welcome Jim, who's the principal at Salem. And Jim would like to know, what is the main prey of a leopard? Well, Jim, small to medium-sized antelope, impala, steenbok, duiker, and I'm really hoping we're going to be able to show you one of them. There's lots of footprints here, so hopefully there'll be one around the corner. So as I was saying, Jim, so small to medium-sized antelope, and occasionally a male leopard will take a large antelope like a kudu, but generally it's your small to medium-sized antelope. Although leopards do have male leopards in particular do have a great fondness for warthog, but a big boar like that might prove a bit difficult. Although some of our male leopards here actually specialize in warthog. Our dominant male Tingana, we've actually seen him go underground to pull a warthog out of its hole. Well done, Darlene. You are spot on, 100% correct. Antelope have horns that are permanent. Deer have branched antlers and they fall off outside of the mating season. Where there is an antelope, has got his horns for life. And I think I know where some horns are close by. Not quite antelope horns, but they'll do for an explanation. Oh, we always check. This is also a very good area to look for leopard, and they like the thickets along the side of this dry river. And you never know, Queen Karula might be back on the property. Queen Karula is our dominant female leopard, as she's been nicknamed the Queen by our many Safari Live fans. There's an Impala! So, there we go. Now, Jim, I know you're the principal. I keep wanting to say, sir. Well, there, sir, we have some Impala, and that is one of a leopard's favorite foods. They are quite elegant antelope. They're the most numerous antelope in Africa, south of the Sahara. And they are very adaptable. So they're both grazers and browsers, which enables them to inhabit a variety of different habitats. And for me, one of the most amazing things about them is they are such an evolutionary success that they have remained unchanged for the last 1.6 million years. So if you deem survival as success, an impala is a more successful species than a human being. Okay, now we are heading to a big evergreen tree we get here called the jackalberry, and we're going to go see if there's anything feeding on the fruits. It's just started fruiting while we make our way towards that wonderful big tree. Let's jump back on board with Alan and see what he's got.
Wonderful to have you back. Since we left one another, we've just been trolling along these kind of dry riverbeds, or as we call them, drainage systems, which crisscross this bushveld countryside here. And you know, it's an area that one might hope to find animals resting during this hotter part of the day, as we stare into the sun right now. There are some impala feeding close by. I understand Brent's also just seen a group of impala that he's been discussing with you. Now, Missy, a question from you asking what the temperature is right now. So Celsius wise, it's about 30 degrees Celsius, Missy, which is probably early 90 degrees Fahrenheit, and it's a dry, comfortable heat. You know, it's not excruciatingly hot, but certainly from an animal point of view, it would be a period of awakening as to what's heralded. You know, we're coming out of our winter time here in the Southern Hemisphere, and we are expecting to burst into summer. And yeah, the temperatures will rise. They will rise fairly high, but again, it's all of the wildlife and the plant life and everything is on this in this area is has evolved to work perfectly in such conditions. It's just us humans that end up needing a little bit of refreshment and respite every now and again. But yeah, the drainage systems that we were driving alongside earlier on, Angela's asking if I've had an animal attack or charge at me. Angela, you know, there are occasions, certainly in this industry, you spent enough time in it where animals do show hostility towards you if you're on foot or perhaps the vehicle. But I've been very fortunate enough not to have ever had to come into physical contact with an animal as it shows its dis-ease or dissatisfaction for my presence. But certainly there are times when animals will show hostility towards the vehicles to try and create space if they're uncomfortable with us. And but yeah, for the most part, it's just a display, and it's a display that we need to generally heed take heed of and offer the animals the comfort. And it's really just in order to create distance so that they can carry on their lives unimpeded by our presence, and we can just enjoy watching them doing what they want to do naturally. Madeline, thank you for your question regarding whether or not it's scary to be out here alone with wild animals. I don't think scary is really a way to describe it. I think there's certainly city environments where it would be warranted to be a lot more afraid than one tends to be out here. Respectful and just an amazing enjoyment of being able to spend time in these natural areas it's a great privilege. But there are times where animals will display in a hostile fashion towards you, and no matter what anyone says, it's an intimidating situation to be part of, and it's designed as such. It's designed to intimidate you. It's designed to create space and to recreate boundaries. And I never ever take those for granted, and certainly any animal, big or small, that's presenting itself in a fashion that's designed to intimidate you, they do it in a very, very good way. There's definitely times where you can feel incredibly humbled by the species that we enjoy to view out here, but cities are definitely a far more dangerous environment in terms of physical health. Right, I'm going to carry on driving a little bit more. We're staring straight into the sun, and this group of impala seems to have filtered off down into the shadows. So we'll just carry on looking, and I would like to hand you back to Brett for a short while as we carry on looking to see what we got ahead of us. Okay, you're going to stay with me. Shannon, your question regarding the Big Five and its representation in this area. Yes, certainly. The Big Five is well represented in this game reserve and in the Kruger National Park as such. For those of you who are not familiar, the Big Five is actually a categorization of animals based on what was deemed to be their danger to man from a hunting perspective. So, in the early parts of the 1900s, late 1800s, where these dramatic early, do you see that?
An owl.
Okay. Sorry, I'll get back to your question shortly about the Big Five. I think we may have spotted an owl, which being broad daylight is not the most common of sightings, so let's see what we can make of this. I haven't seen it yet, but let's just see. In there? Where are you looking, sir?
Inside, you see the buffalo, the tallest buffalo thorn?
Yeah.
Come down its main stem.
Yeah.
We can see. In the foreground, in the, on the glory.
Okay. Oh, jeez, like, sorry. Can you see it?
See this white branch in front of us with the white?
And zoom in now, and down, 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 and left now, and straight middle frame, up, up, up. So now you're in the center frame, is it there? How gorgeous. Now, Steph is sitting, can I talk? Steph is sitting in the back of the car, and and he has just spotted this tiny, tiny owl, which looks like a barred owl, actually. One of the smallest owls. There are three very, very small of these owls, a barred owl. If it was a pearl-spotted owl, which is another, probably the smallest, it would have very prominent black spots on the back of its head, false eye spot, false feathers, or feathers designed to look like eyes on the back of the head. But this is a barred owl or barred owlet, and some of these smaller owls are what we may term crepuscular in habit, meaning that they do spend a fair amount of time operating in daytime because they tend to eat a fair amount of insects, locusts, grasshoppers, mantids, and beetles, which might be easier for them to locate in the daytime. The larger owls, which target some of the more nocturnal species like mice and so on, tend to be, oh, look at those beautiful eyes, just spectacular. I mean, this is such a privilege to get to see this beautiful bird right out in the open, and incredibly good camera work to get it so frozen. Oh, it's heard something. Now, owls, contrary to popular belief, actually use their hearing a great deal more than their eyesight in order to find food. So look at him, he's just staring at us. A rather disdainful look in amongst those. Look at the, if you can look on the sides of the beak, those bristles, they're called rictal bristles, just at the base of the beak, those extended little feathers. And the design of those is one which is very important to this owl. As a grasshopper, which is clasped in that very short beak, kicking around with those spiny legs may very easily damage an eye, and the bristles surrounding the base of the beak, apart from them being of a sensory nature, will give due warning to the eyeball that it's about to get kicked by a spiny tarsal joint of a grasshopper or locust. So those are very important. But back to the fact that these birds have this extraordinary capacity to hear sounds. They just look at the way that it's rotating its head almost 260 degrees, enabling it to completely turn its head without moving its body, finding out all about its environment without needing to shuffle and perhaps give its cryptic body away to any unwanted observers. Moving the head forward, those giant eyeballs are not really capable of focusing too easily because they are enormous in their sockets. So the owl actually bobs its head to gain acute focus on these small objects that it might want to feed upon. So anything that makes a sound, the owl will then hear it and then try and find it via sight, but it does not necessarily need to see its food, particularly at night. For the nocturnal hunting owls, they will be able to parabolate the position of their food simply by hearing its movements, which is an extraordinary feature, and I don't think one that is known by too many. Look at that pivoting of the head. They've actually got specifically designed, yeah? Monique in Wales? Monique in Wales is asking what sort of call this owl actually has. You know, in my 23 plus 20 years of spending time in the bush, I've never actually been able to mimic animal or bird calls particularly well, and I do so sometimes on my own, but certainly on this occasion I'm not going to attempt to mimic the call for you, Monique, but they do have rather an un-owl-like sound. It's a trilling, sort of descending a series of fairly high-pitched notes, very unlike the typical or conventional hooting sound that one might attribute to an owl or associate with an owl. These smaller owls have got very, very intriguing high-pitched calls, and I will play this call for you on my... I don't actually have my iPad with me, but suffice to say that if you were to Google the call of a barred owlet, I'm sure there will be a good recording of it. Otherwise, alternatively, we can play it for you in a catch-up session tomorrow, perhaps. But thank you for the question, and I'll become suitably prepared. So, what an incredible privilege to have enjoyed this owl, and thanks to Steph for spotting it so brilliantly. I'm going to leave it before we disturb it and hand you over to Brent, who I believe might have some lions, or at least some evidence of lions, and we'll carry on in our pursuit of what else is out here. Thank you so much.
Well, yay! The Nkuhumas have come out of the drainage system. They're right on the edge, and at the moment I can only see two lionesses and a pile of cubs, and of course one of the youngsters has come to inspect us. Where's Mom off to now? I think there could be another lioness lying in the shade down there, or she might just be tired of suckling. Now hopefully they might head towards the Gallagher waterhole. Look at that, absolutely gorgeous little backlit lion cubs. So she could have just got really hot where she was and just moving spots. I've still got that little one. Has decided we're not that interesting anymore. Oh. So you can just see a leg up in the air over there as she's hiding from the heat. And then a couple of cubs there, but all the little ones have come out of the thicket with that other lioness now. They're all greeting her. It looks like they might start suckling. Doing them a good clean. And we've been so spoilt with the Nkuhumas recently. It's like they live on our doorstep. We are serenaded by them every evening and get to see them every day. Position slightly. See if we can roll forward a little bit. How's that, Vim? Tell me when you get a gap. a little bit more. Hopefully we don't fall in the hole. There we go. Now, James is wondering, do I think the lions get to know the sound of our voices, or is it like the smell and sound of the cars? What I think is that if you speak calmly, if I had to start shouting and screaming, the lions would get a fright and probably run away. So I think it's more the tone of the voices that we use. Sorry, I'm going to be on the cam drive a second. Herbie, Steph's not driving. Look at that. So, there's that lovely with the backlight coming through. I hope you guys are getting some screenshots. And remember,